Samantha Karatsa, Chair of the Mildura Writers Festival. And on behalf of the committee and the Arts and Mildura Board, it's really an absolute pleasure to welcome you, to welcome our guest writers and other notable guests to this opening night, the first night of our festival here at the club. Funding bodies, sponsors and patrons are really our lifeblood, enabling us to continue with our program every year. I'd like to say a collective thank you to each of these for their support, and we encourage you to note these supporters. They're on the inside page of your, on the back page of your program, and here at the front, here at the podium. And please support these sponsors as they supported us. We're very grateful to the Melbourne American Consulate for the assistance provided to our festival in the form of a generous grant that has enabled us to include US author Liz Moore, who you'll be hearing more of later tonight. We're also immensely pleased that on top of that assistance, we have been graced by a visit from the US Consul General himself, Frank Urban Sick Jr., who is with us tonight. Consul General Urban Sick is welcome here tonight, not only for the high office he represents, but also because he is a lover of literature and a man of knowledge. He completed a BA in French literature from New York University and a master's in Byzantine history. He's a native of Indianapolis. He speaks French, Arabic, and Turkish, with additional studies in Greek. Of course, he has had a most distinguished career in diplomacy, serving in the Middle East, Africa, Canada, and was most recently the ambassador to Cyprus. Consul General Urban Sick has held important positions in the Office of the Coordinator for Counterterrorism, where he was responsible for managing and overseeing all aspects of counterterrorism activities. He has dealt with terrorism and its roots throughout his career. But hopefully, his expertise will not be needed here tonight. We are indeed lucky to live in a very peaceful part of the world. It's now a pleasure for me to call on our Mayor, Councillor John Arnold, to formally welcome the Consul General.
Well, thank you very much, Donato. It's very pleasing to be here tonight to celebrate the first night of Arts Mildura, Mildura Writers Festival. Before I start, I would like to pay our respect to the traditional owners of the land, the Lhadji Lhadji people and their names, the Barkindjis, and to their elders past and present. Well, tonight is a very special occasion. We've just come from, or many of us have just come from, a wonderful exhibition of 20 young Americans, and two Canadians, I think, which was quite enlightening. And tonight to be here with the Consul General, we welcome you along, Consul General, to Mildura. You've had a nice day today, and I'm sure that your visit will be very pleasant, as Mildura is, and we certainly are very appreciative that you're able to come along to be part of not only our community, but also tonight here at the Writers' Festival, to officially open the festival. Mildura, of course, if you look back at the history, was set up by two Canadians, the Chaffee brothers, who came here at the request of Alfred Deakin 125 years ago, just last month, to set up Mildura as an irrigation colony. And we still have very close ties with our sister city, Upland, where the Chaffee brothers also set up exactly the same sort of settlement in Mildura. In fact, if you went out into Deakin Avenue just outside and to Euclid Avenue in Upland, you'd probably think you were in the same place. And I was explaining that to some of the young Americans that were at the exhibition. And I think one of them said, we'll have to go and have a look. Maybe they want to check to see if I was right or not. But that relationship is still very strong, and we have a sister city association, and visitors from your country came here for our 125th celebration of the signing of the indenture. And recently we've agreed to form a sister city relationship with Brockville in Canada, which is the birthplace of the Chaffees. So that's very special. Tonight also we have Professor Paul Kane, who is the head of Vassar College, and his wife Trudy, who is formerly the director of the Metropolitan Museum of Modern Art. And they've been involved now for 17 years with the festival, which is quite outstanding. They come each year from the States to be here, put in a tremendous amount of work. And when you see that relationship and that dedication for what's been put together, it's quite special. And I'm very pleased that work is at the hearts of what the Writers' Festival is about, the hearts of what an arts in our community is all about. And we spoke before about the capital cities and the regional areas. Well, I can assure everyone that the regional city of Mildura has very special place for the arts, writers, and all those things that go along. In fact, there's more than 300 different events happen across this district, and the Arts Festival is responsible for not only this, but also for the Arts Festival in March, the Jazz Food and Wine Festival. And to me, that shows that our community is up there with what I would call a very modern, regional, metro-type city. And to Paul and Tarina, I think that is very special. But also I'd like to thank the Arts Festival Committee. You'll note on the front of the podium there's 25 different sponsors for tonight. And to Ross Lake and your team, to put together such an amount of exciting events is something which is quite unique. Back in 1934, Mildura was formed as a city. It was a borough initially, then became a shire, and until 1995 it was a city. And on the plaque that was the city emblem, the motto was, "You shall know them by your fruits," which come, of course, from the biblical time when Jesus made that statement about certain things were happening in I think it was in Jerusalem at the time. But Mildura, well-known Consul General for fruits, the diverse production of agriculture and the food that we produce is certainly the first class up there, and the food bowl of the nation was stretched right along the Mildura. And while we've had some difficult times, I can always remember that the Chafee brothers had a vision, and the vision was to make this land, this fertile land, the food bowl, to produce food, to produce good food and good wine too, which is not too bad. I might even give that a bit of a nudge perhaps later on. To keep that vision is about what a community is about, not just about where we go to work, we do this, we get into the council when things go wrong, but we have a vision of good things, arts, culture, all the fun and things we enjoy in our life. So to me, that is a very special part of being in a very rich community. I'm sure that while you're here, Consul General, I've already seen some of the things that happen in the area, quite unique, and we also have a lot of secondary industries which carry on from that. So welcome to Mildura. To Paul and Trina, thank you so much. I'm sure that what transpires over the next 3 days will warm the hearts of all those people who are involved. It almost looks like we've got the on the couch tonight. I don't know whether Stefano is going to sit up there and talk, but we'll leave that to later. Sure, if he does, we'll hear it. but I'd just like to say to everyone here tonight also, if you're a visitor to Mildura, you're most welcome. Council is very supportive of events. In fact, they are quite unique what we do here, and I'm sure that many other communities would be the envy of what we're able to do. So I'd like to, before I introduce the Consul General, ask you to come forward. I'll have a gift for you on behalf of our community. The fruits that I talked about, you shall know them by your fruits, are inside the chocolate. I hope you like that. But there's also some of our produce. I'd like you to come forward to make a small presentation. Street that before, and a couple of people want to know if they had a bike. I said, not tonight. It must have been too much food out tonight. Well, without any further ado, I'd just like to now pay a special welcome, as I said, to our Consul General from the United States, Frank Ervesich. Frank looks after Victoria, South Australia, Northern Territory, and he's the sandwich, and the filling in the sandwich. He's in the middle of everything else, so he's got all the action. So please, ladies and gentlemen, give a big welcome to the US Consul General, Frank Ervesich.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's my great honor to be here. It's because, actually, of the leadership that you've exhibited, because of the great initiatives that this city has taken to support the arts and to bring about this writers' event, that I made a special effort and wanted to come here. Wanted to celebrate with Liz, who's joining us from the United States, and to be with the people of this regional regional city. I myself come from a region, from a very small state in the United States, and I understand that the leadership in those states frequently comes from the ground up. The capital follows the lead of the regions, and certainly I think Moldura has every reason to raise its head very high, and you have very much to be proud of with your people for the great project that you're undertaking and for the great success that we can already see. Look at the attendance that we have. Donna, you were correct. I did do all those things in counterterrorism, and if you want to talk someday about all the people that would like to kill us, I suppose we can do that. But I also serve on the Fulbright Commission here, and I served on the Fulbright Commission in Cyprus when I was ambassador there. I am a fan of E. Cummins, and some of you may make some of you happy, and maybe not, but in any case, I do have a certain literary side that I like to indulge, especially reading Byzantine history and those kinds of things. So don't keep me just to that one aspect. I'm also particularly proud that we, as the United States government, were able to support, first of all, Liz in coming, and also to support the writers here tonight. The United States boasts an extraordinary literary tradition. We have a long, long list of important world class authors that many of you will be familiar with. One of my favorite, Mark Twain. You really can't beat him for sarcasm and for brilliance. Edith Wharton, F. Scott Fitzgerald, another of my favorite for a completely different reason. Jonathan Franzen, Jeffrey Evgenides, and lots of others. I won't go through the list that I've got here in the paper. But E.M. Forster said that what is wonderful about great literature is that it transforms the man who reads it toward the condition of the man who wrote it. And I think that's really what we're talking about here. We're talking about the ability of writers to share experiences and to make those experiences real to other people who haven't shared those experiences. Or in the same way as education, from the group of students that we just came from celebrating with their photography from the United States tonight. It's a new way of looking at the world that had not been considered by an individual before. The United States is very proud, Mr. Mayor, to be part of this. We're very proud to support it. We want to thank you, Donna, for all of your support, congratulate you for what you've done, and tell you how much we look forward to participating in the events coming up in the next couple of days. So it's a great honor to be here, and thank you very much for having me.
Authors in the United States who graciously agreed to come all the way out from Philadelphia. She arrived yesterday and flew up this morning to Moldura. If she starts to fall asleep, we have a shepherd's hook, which we will prod her with to keep her going. We are all very excited.
The cattle prod, Paul, the cattle prod.
We use something else actually in the States, but I won't. And Liz, of course, is the author of two very well-received novels and is somebody that has come out courtesy of the U.S. Consul General, and we're very pleased that we've been able to establish our relationship. So please give a warm welcome to both Morag and Liz.
Thank you very much, Paul, and welcome to Australia, please.
Thank you so much. And it's been a wonderful 24 hours.
Welcome particularly to Mildura, which I think is a home away from home for not just Paul and Tina, but many Americans that come here, and a lot of us. There's a lot of traffic between the US, both coasts, and here, so you're very, very welcome.
Thank you, and I would especially like to say thank you to everybody who's just spoken, and you. It's really great to be here.
She's done 16, Liz thinks 16 hours is a long flight.
Before I got on the plane, I made the mistake of reading an article about how Qantas was rethinking that flight and the size of the plane because they thought it might be, I guess it keeps having to stop to refuel in the middle of it, so that was a comforting thing to read before I leave.
All right, let's start talking about Liz's writing. Liz has published essays in journals that veteran writers would be very pleased to have their byline in, and she has two novels to her credit. I'm not going to ask you how old you are. The first is The Words of Every Song, this one, which was published in 2007, and most recently, 2012. Is that in the US as well as here?
Yeah, both here in the US. Mm-hmm.
So this is an author tour, really, isn't it?
Yeah. Part of one, yeah.
Yeah, Heft, wonderfully titled. So, the first one, I can understand where it came from. Liz has other talents. She's a musician, she's a singer, she's a songwriter, and a guitarist. And the words of every song partly come from that experience. But Heft is a whole different thing, isn't it? So I suppose I want to know just initially, where's life for you now? Are you a musician, or are you a writer, or how do you juggle those two things?
Well, let's see, I sort of identify myself as a writer and a musician and a teacher, but unfortunately I sort of feel capable only of doing two out of three of those things at a time. So when I moved to Philadelphia, it was for a full-time teaching job, which means that writing has taken precedence over music for the time being, and I'm really only really teaching and writing at the moment, although I'd love to keep music part of my life and hope to return to it someday, maybe when I've paid my dues a little bit as a professor and don't have a 4-4 course load. So,
did I bleed into one at all?
Some music and yes, they do. Although when I was doing both regularly, I found that I had to take any creative impulse that I had and immediately assign it to either music or writing, which sometimes lowered my production in both. So now that I've kind of just made the decision to write as much as I possibly can, I don't have to make that decision anymore, which means that any grain of creativity that I come across, I funnel immediately into writing. But I suppose they're related. I mean, they're both, especially songwriting, of course, is related to writing fiction and nonfiction. There's a certain element of, there's a generative element to it, sort of taking whatever's in your brain and making it hopefully appealing to someone outside yourself, I suppose. Yeah.
Because you use the words of songwriting, and lyric is the one that comes immediately to my mind, which tells you how old I am, but you use those words to introduce a lot of chapters in the words of every song, for example. So,
yeah.
Obviously, for someone like Cohen, writing and music has coexisted for decades.
Yeah, in the words of every song, it's a series of linked stories. There's a shared cast of characters, and each chapter centers on a different character, and each chapter opens with a different quote from a different song, a lot of different types of songs.
Tell us the musicians and the songs, just to set you in time.
Let's see.
Well, let's start with Cohen.
The title of Words of Every Song comes from a Leonard Cohen song called Teachers, and Cohen appears, and not physically or even by name, but he's in the book as well, in a couple of different places. Let's see, who else is in there? Natalie Merchant, Lauryn Hill,
The Clash,
yeah. I told Mark before we started that the Words of Every Song came out in 2007, and I made the mistake of including such a large cast of characters that sometimes I can't remember their names. So that's off the top. There's 14 different songs. Those are some of them.
Now, I've had the advantage of reading both of his novels since they arrived very welcome in my litter box. But most of you here will not, because only just recently been published in Australia.
That's right, Heft, I think, was published this month.
Okay, so I'd really like people here to hear what I heard and hear the voice of the novel. So I was just wondering, I can see the provenance of the words of every song, I can see what experience it came out of, but Heft just moves into another dimension. So I thought I might ask Liz to read from the beginning of Heft. Let's just hear the words, and then when she's finished reading an introductory section, I'm going to ask her to tell us a little bit about the novel. I don't want to give it away. It's not a crime, sure, but there are things she can't tell you. But just to give us a synopsis, let's hear a bit first.
Sure. So this is how the book begins. The first thing you must know about me is that I am colossally fat. When I knew you, I was what one might call plump, but I am no longer plump. I eat what I want, and furthermore, I eat whenever I want. For years, I have made very little effort to reduce the amount that I eat, for I have seen no cause to. Despite this, I am neither immobile nor bedridden, but I do feel winded when I walk more than 6 or 7 steps, and I do feel very shy and sort of encased in something, as if I were a cello or an expensive gun. I have no way of knowing exactly what I weigh, but I estimate that it is between 500 and 600 pounds. The last time I went to a doctor's office was years ago, and back then I weighed 480 pounds, and they had to put me on a special scale. The doctor looked at me and told me I was very surely on a path toward early death. Second, in my letters to you these 2 decades, I have been untruthful by omission. For shortly after I last saw you, a variety of circumstances combined to make it impossible for me to continue my academic career. About this, about many things, I have been unforthcoming. My references to former friends and colleagues and memories. I have not worked as a professor for 18 years. Last and most important, I no longer go out of my house. Fortunately, it is a very nice house, and largely I am proud of it. I did not purchase it, it was bestowed upon me. It is 25 feet wide, very wide for this block. And once it was very lovely inside and out, decorated very nicely, though this is when I was a small boy. But now I fear I have allowed it to fall into a sort of haunted disrepair. Only scraps of its loveliness remain. The piano I played when I was a boy, the bookshelves around the fireplace, the furniture, which once was what they call high-end, but at this point has been sinking slowly toward the floor for 40 years because it has borne the weight of me on its back. There are nice things on the upper floors, I suppose, but I haven't seen them in a decade. I have no reason to go up there. I couldn't if I tried. My bedroom and everything I need are on this floor, my little world, and outside my window is the only view I need. The state of the house is one of the things I'm most ashamed of, for I have always loved the house, and sometimes when I am sentimental, I feel the house loves me as well. Because I no longer go outside, I've become very good at ordering whatever I need online. My home sometimes feels like a shipping center. Every day, sometimes twice a day, somebody brings something to me. The FedEx man, the UPS man. So you see, I'm not entirely a shut-in, because I'm assigned for these things. And what leaves my house does so in garbage bags that I toss to the curb from my top step very late at night when it's dark out. There are companies now for everything. One for bringing you your books and newspapers and magazines. One for sending you supplies you might need from a pharmacy. Even one that lets you order your groceries online and then brings them to your house for you. An old-fashioned concept in some ways, a wonderful innovation in others. Once a week, I select my supplies on their website. They have everything, this company, everything you could possibly think of. Prepared foods and raw ingredients, desserts and breakfasts and wine and toilet paper, cheese and deli meat and ice cream and cake and bagels and pop-ums, little doughy confections that Entenmann's bakes and then sprinkles with holiday-themed colors. Now it is October, and my poems are orange and black.
You'll have to explain to students why they're orange and black. I love that detail.
Halloween. The color of Halloween is arbitrary. I'm sure there's some historical explanation for it, orange and black. Yeah. A man brings my food to my home on Tuesday nights. I made sure to choose the after 5 p.m. option when I joined, which pleases me. I like to think that the delivery man might believe I work all day and I'm just getting home. I'm very silly in this way. On the phone with customer service representatives, I casually mention family or work. "How are you today, Mr. Ott?" asks the lady representative from Bank of America, and I sigh and say, "Swamped," a little joke. In the same way, I delight in answering the door for my grocery delivery with a tie loosened about my neck and an air of exhaustion and world-weary distractedness. "You can leave it just inside the door," I always say, and then walk into the kitchen, calling back over my shoulder little mundanities about the weather or a sports team. Once the boxes are all accounted for, I tip the driver with cash that I keep hidden in a drawer on my nightstand on the inside of a hollow book. I obtained the book as a child. It was my prized possession, a hollow book, and it has proven useful to me since. All the food I order for delivery is paid for by credit card on the phone. Tipping is the only thing I need cash for, so for a long time I relied on the large store of bills that years ago I procured from the bank. I have no plan for when they run out. I never thought I'd need one.
Give us a little bit of a synopsis of where Arthur sits and what's going to happen and who the other two major characters. Well, there's three actually with Yolanda. It's just so that we have some sense of where Heft goes.
Sure. The voice in which I was reading was the voice of Arthur Opp, who in some ways is the protagonist of the book. And you sort of know everything you need to know about him. At the start of the book, he hasn't left his home in years, and he has become really morbidly obese. The other main character in the book is a 17-year-old baseball star who's in his last year of high school, and he is the son of Charlene, who is the link between Arthur and Cal. She was a former student of Arthur Opp's when he was teaching. And the book is sort of the story of how Arthur and Kel, how their lives intersect, how their lives cross. And there's a fourth main character named Yolanda, who's a young woman who comes in to clean Arthur's house around chapter 3. So those are the main characters.
Okay, and in Arthur Opp you have this extraordinary character. I mean, he's self-destructive, he's deeply bizarre, and yet he's enormously, I mean, think of just from that really, enormously compelling. You like your characters, and forgive the pun, very rounded, don't you? But I think you also really like your characters. Is that true?
I do. Do you think that's true of all authors? Do you think all authors like their... No, maybe.
No.
I'm sure we can name a few.
Think it's a very interesting creative principle, whether you do or you don't, or what you do. But I want to know whether you do and why you do. And
I have, right. I suppose I have trouble, I don't want to say not liking anyone, because certainly there are people that I vehemently don't like in life. But I guess it's, for me, it feels like once I'm fully inside of a voice or inside of a character, it becomes hard for me to completely dislike them or to completely write them off, especially when I'm writing in the first person, because it sort of feels like me at a certain point. I mean, I have to find something likable about them for my own self-preservation, I guess. And it's interesting to me to seek out what's good about a person. I think that makes life much more interesting than trying to find out everything that's bad about a person, because I think for one reason or another, human beings present their bad sides first, maybe, or I don't know, not always, but I suppose it's easier to write off a character or a person than it is to seek out the goodness in them.
You said, interestingly, when you're in the first person voice, so where does Arthur come from, and where does that voice? Because it's very much, it's not your voice, it's his voice.
Yeah. So where's it come from?
Well,
this even morbidly obese sounds sort of limiting of the character of the humans, isn't it?
It is, and I guess immediately certain assumptions are made about a character who's morbidly obese, or you know, certain references immediately come to mind. And there is an archetype of an obese person in literature, and there's, I suppose, there's a stereotype in life. And I wanted very much to avoid both of those things by thinking about Arthur first as somebody, you know, a person who was obese rather than an obese person. And his voice took a long time to find, actually. I began by writing Heft completely in the third person, alternating close third person points of view between four of the characters. And I wrote almost a complete draft that way. And then,
so Yolanda had a voice.
Yolanda had a close third person. I mean, as much as of a voice as you can have in the third person, but it was in her head. It was not working in a major way. That's putting it lightly. I knew that it wasn't working, and I had that dreadful sinking feeling that you have when you're writing something that you don't like, but you feel compelled to keep writing it. And I really got hundreds of pages done in that third-person voice, or those third-person voices, before I remember very distinctly when I first sort of came across Arthur's voice, and oddly, because I don't think it's like his voice, but I was at a reading by the poet Mark Strand, and it was while I was in...
private joking, please explain.
I think there any, yeah... poet. I'm not sure, what was that laughter about there?
He's not like Arthur.
No, he's not, for one thing, he's very skinny and tall. And I was sitting there listening to him, and all of a sudden, I had my journal, and I started writing started writing that opening paragraph. And one thing about the book that you wouldn't know from hearing it aloud is that I use weird, I use ampersands a lot instead of the word and when I'm writing in Arthur's voice, and I abbreviate certain words of his. Sometimes he'll write T-H-O instead of the full word though, and he uses the letter O instead of O-H, and all of that sort of, after hundreds of pages of work, kind of tumbled out of me.
Yes, because the expression that you used was, I came across
Right.
Arthur's voice, so he's become not you, he's somewhere
yeah.
that you couldn't find.
And I think maybe, as much as it pained me to, you know, that revelation came with the painful other realization that I would have to rewrite the entire thing after I put in, you know, I had basically a complete draft. So it took another 2 or 3 years of work to finish the book in Arthur's voice, and then finding Kel's voice was another process. But it was a good moment, despite the fact that I knew it would involve more work, because I knew as soon as I came across that voice that I knew it was right. It just felt unequivocally right. There wasn't really an option after that.
Give us a little bit of a synopsis of where Arthur sits and what's going to happen, and who the other two major characters, well, there's three actually, Miranda. It's just so that we have some sense of where Heft goes.
Sure. The voice in which I was reading was the voice of Arthur Opp, who in some ways is the protagonist of the book. And you sort of know everything you need to know about him at the start of the book. He hasn't left his home in years, and he has become really morbidly obese. The other main character in the book is a 17-year-old baseball star who's in his last year of high school. And he is the son of Charlene, who is the link between Arthur and Kel. She was a former student of Arthur Opp's when he was teaching. And the book is sort of the story of how Arthur and Kel, how their lives intersect, how their lives cross. And there's a fourth main character named Yolanda, who's a young woman who comes in to clean Arthur's house around chapter 3. So those are the main characters.
Okay, and in Arthur Opp you have this extraordinary character, and he's self-destructive, he's deeply bizarre, and yet he's enormously, I think just from that really, enormously compelling. You like your characters of a given kind very rounded, don't you? But I think you also really like your characters. Is that true?
I do. Do you think that's true of all authors? Do you think all authors like it? No, maybe.
No.
I'm sure we can name a few.
I think it's a very interesting creative principle, whether you do or you don't, or what you do. But I want to know why you, whether you do and why you do. And
I have, right. I suppose I have trouble, I don't want to say not liking anyone, because certainly there are people that I vehemently don't like in life, but I guess it's, for me it feels like once I'm fully inside of a voice or inside of a character, it becomes hard for me to completely dislike them or completely write them off, especially when I'm writing in the first person, because it sort of feels like me at a certain point. I mean, I have to find something likable about them for my own self-preservation, I guess. And it's interesting to me to seek out what's good about a person. I think that makes life much more interesting than trying to find out everything that's bad about a person, because I think for one reason or another, human beings present their bad sides first, maybe, or I don't know, not always, but I suppose it's easier to write off a character or a person than it is to seek out the goodness in them.
You said, interestingly, when you're in the first person voice, so where does answer come from? Where does that voice, because it's very much, it's not your voice, it's his voice.
Yeah.
Where does it come from?
Well,
it's more, even morbidly obese sounds sort of limiting of the character he is, isn't it?
It is, and I guess immediately certain assumptions are made about a character who's morbidly obese, or you know, certain references immediately come to mind. And there is an archetype of an obese person in literature, and I suppose there's a stereotype in life. And I wanted very much to avoid both of those things by thinking about Arthur first as somebody, you know, a person who was obese rather than an obese person. And his voice took a long time to find, actually. I began by writing Heft completely in the third person, alternating close third person points of view between four of the characters. And I wrote almost a complete draft that way. And then.
So Yolanda had a voice?
Yolanda had a close third person, I mean, as much as of a voice as you can have in the third person, but it was in her head. It was not working in a major way. That's putting it lightly. I knew that it wasn't working, and I had that dreadful sinking feeling that you have when you're writing something that you don't like, but you feel compelled to keep writing it. And I really got hundreds of pages done in that third person voice, or those third person voices, before I remember very distinctly when I first sort of came across Arthur's voice, and oddly, because I don't think it's like his voice, but I was at a reading by the poet Mark Strand, and it was while I was in poet. I'm not sure, what was that laughter about?
he's not like Arthur.
No, for one thing, he's very skinny and tall. And, but I was sitting there listening to him, and all of a sudden I had my journal and I started writing that opening paragraph. And one thing about the book that you wouldn't know from hearing it aloud is that I use I use ampersands a lot instead of the word and when I'm writing in Arthur's voice, and I abbreviate certain words of his. Sometimes he'll write tho instead of the full word though, and he uses the letter o instead of oh, and all of that sort of, after hundreds of pages of work, kind of tumbled out of me.
Because the expression that you used was, I came across Arthur's voice, so he's become not you, he's somewhere you couldn't find.
And I think maybe, as much as it pained me to, you know, that revelation came with the painful other realization that I would have to rewrite the entire thing after I put in you know, I had basically a complete draft. So it took another 2 or 3 years of work to finish the book in Arthur's voice, and then finding Kel's voice was another process. But it was a good moment, despite the fact that I knew it would involve more work, because I knew as soon as I came across that voice that I knew it was right. It just felt, unequivocally right. There wasn't really an option after that.
And the other three characters, where did you find, was it as easy to find, or not easy, but did they drop out of the sky, or was it a development of finding Arthur's voice?
Kel is so different.
Kel's, you know, hormonally charged, best form.
I had to drop any close voice from the point of view of Charlene and Yolanda once I ended up alternating between two first-person voices, the voice of Arthur and the voice of Kel. Kel's voice is the voice of a teenage boy, which I never was. So I had to sort of dream up what that might sound like.
I wondered about that, because it's so much in his system, on his language. I mean, did you go, you got brothers?
No brothers, no.
Where'd you go? Who
did
you listen to?
I listened to, my fiancé was sort of a jock, which is weird because I was not, but I listened to him talk about his own, I think that's the first time I've ever admitted that out loud, and I only felt comfortable doing it because I'm in Australia. I've never
watched it.
He played basketball in college, and he still watches lots of sports, which I sort of avoid as much as possible, despite the fact that I wrote a lot about baseball in this book. But it was really partly hearing Mac talk about his experience growing up and the particular pressures that I think boys face, that I was interested in. And also, I grew up in what I would call a working class town surrounded by a lot of rich towns in Massachusetts. And there were a lot of boys that I grew up with that I was very intimidated by when I was growing up, and was sort of shy around. And then as an adult, I'm able to sort of look back on them and think, you know, think about the troubles that they were facing and think about what particular issues they would have been dealing with at home, which certainly surpassed my own in terms of their severity. And it was an interesting thing to go back and think about how to empathize with them, despite the fact that sometimes they were terrors and sometimes they, you know, brutalized other people. But it was good. It was sort of like developing empathy belatedly.
It's interesting because it's not Holden Caulfield. And that must shadow anyone writing about adolescent boys, because it's quite—it's thrown right forward, and he has absolutely his own voice, as you find when you read it.
Mm-hmm. That's a comparison that has been made, but it's not.
No.
Other people have made that comparison, but it's not. I mean, I think it's impossible to write a first person voice of a boy that age, if you've read Salinger without thinking of Holden Caulfield in some way. He created a thing, and I think it's hard to escape when you're writing the first person voice of a teenage boy. And anyway, it was what I tried to do with his voice, whether I realized it or not. You know, maybe I'm just thinking this looking back on it, but there's a kind of a breathlessness or a comma-lessness in his voice that made sense to me, because I pictured him sort of mumbling a lot and not wanting to come out with whatever he was thinking. So some of the words that he uses are probably not words that a boy like him would speak aloud, but it was my attempt to render what I thought his thoughts might be, or what he would say if he didn't have something stopping him from saying it.
And the other character, Charlene, who has this early relationship, platonic or whatever, with Arthur. I mean, that's a hard voice to find, isn't it?
Yeah,
she's a complex character.
Yeah. So Charlene is the was the she was a student of Arthur's, and she it's difficult to describe their relationship exactly without kind of giving the book away. But it was platonic, romantic. Yeah. It was there was a borderline, and it actually resulted in the end of Arthur's job at the university, which is revealed pretty early on in the book. But she doesn't have a voice in this version. And that, I spent a lot of time pondering that because I wish that she could have a voice, but no voice that I came across for her worked, and in the end I decided that it was because she, you know, that was part of her downfall and part of her problem. She suffers greatly in this book, Charlene. She's not, good things don't happen to Charlene.
She has a presence, though.
I like to think so.
She has.
That's good to hear, because I always worry about Charlene, and I always worry that people will think that I don't like her, because she's not easily likable. She's sort of a bad mother, and we don't tend to like bad mothers in literature, it's very hard to overcome, or to do anything else if you're a bad mother, or to be known for anything else, so... That was my difficulty with Charlene.
She's a very loving mom.
She is in her way. She just sort of can't act on it. Yeah.
And Yolanda? Yolanda, see Yolanda is.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that Yolanda is the young woman who comes in to clean Arthur's house. She has dropped out of high school for a couple of different reasons. And I had a good time writing her because, again, I knew girls, I was friends with girls like her growing up, and I sort of like that she's kind of no-nonsense and doesn't suffer fools gladly, which is a quality that I respect and don't have all that much of, so it's kind of like her.
Yeah.
But a lot of people have asked...
We can line the fools up later on, if you can...
What's that?
Yeah, don't worry.
I was worried when writing this book about the fact that there are two women present in it that don't have voices, and that there are two men that do have voices, and I'm a woman, and all I can say is that it wasn't intentional, it just felt like the story went in that direction.
Trust your readers. People read them and see if they think the two women have a voice.
Yeah.
But just look briefly at the words of every song, and as Liz told you, that this is it's a book of 14 separate chapters that really focus on either a group or a single character in those 14 chapters. And it's a book that comes out partly, I imagine, from your experience with the music scene in both New York and Philadelphia. A lot of them are deeply unlikable, egocentric, not eccentric, just egocentric, they don't care about people. And yet, as the book develops and these 14 characters braid and interlace, you start understanding that they have families, they have remorse, they have regrets, they live in houses. And I suppose the word, we talked about this before, I've used, you have this redemptive impulse. I don't mean you're trying to make good characters, but some of it relates to what you were saying before. It's not that you're looking for something good. As you look at them, they've just become much more complex and much more interesting. And is this conscious, or is it just that's the way you write, and the way you think about the
I suppose that is the way that I think about the world, or try to think about the world, which was bred into me by my mother, who would say things like, whenever I would come home and have a complaint about a friend or a bully or anyone I was having trouble with as a child, she would say, well, think about what they have going on at home, or, you know, think about their home life, what's going on there.
Which is
say, can't you just be on my side? But I suppose it is an important thing to teach your children, you know, not to immediately jump to their defense, but to foster some kind of empathy in them by asking them to think about the circumstances of others' lives. And I guess that maybe is where I get it, this thing that I have, I'm not being able to completely write off characters or to seek some explanation for their behavior, which unfortunately is not always there in real life. I mean, I am fully aware that I think some people are just horrible. the words of every song I wrote during a time, I mean, I wrote that when I was very young. I think 19 when I started writing it, and about 22 when I finished it. And I haven't read through it in the past couple of years, but I think there is a youngness in it. I hope so. But I sort of feel like that thing is, I don't know, maybe people are more generous when they're young, or maybe not. I don't know. But it's some of that I wouldn't repeat some of the choices that I made in that book, to be honest with you. Although I do still have that impulse. I'd like to redeem.
What about structure? I don't want to get too technical, but both books are structurally very complex. Mm-hmm. The words of every song, possibly more so. But in Heft, you've got this, all these voices running and different time sequences. You don't make life easy for yourself, do you?
No. Heft was a puzzle to figure. I mean, all books in a way are a puzzle. But there's a lot of information that cannot be revealed at the start, or else you would lose any sense of narrative tension. So that was, there were several moments of, you know, wanting to just completely give up because I didn't feel like there was any way for me to talk about these characters without revealing the thing that would keep the reader reading or that would sustain some kind of tension. And yet you never want that to feel contrived. You never want the reader to lose trust in you because they think you're cheating or that you're intentionally withholding something that of course should be revealed. So I would say that was one of the hardest parts about writing Heft for me, and that's why I'll never be a good mystery writer. Plot has always come
it, after. It's interesting that you have mystery element because it does keep you wondering. It's hard to say what you're wondering about without giving it away.
Let's just give it away.
Well, it maintains the narrative tension to the last sentence, and that must have been hard.
It was a bit hard, but a lot of it was just the idea of, you know, struggling to figure out what it was that I wanted to accomplish artistically. I guess it was more about is this a contrivance? Am I thinking too much about the plot and not enough about the characters? That was tough.
The title's wonderful. Heft. I mean, on a number of levels. When did you arrive at that?
The title Heft came to me pretty early on. I wrote a scene in which the word was used, and it felt to me applicable to both characters in a nice way. There's the obvious association with the word heft of weight, and there's with Kel, I think he's sort of burdened in many ways by his mother, by the expectations of him as an athlete and as a young man. But that this is actually kind of a funny answer. Peter Carey was a professor of mine at Hunter, and he has a book called Theft. And it was very afraid of using the title Heft, and I really worked myself up into a frenzy over the idea that I couldn't use the title Heft because it was only one letter removed. And I spent hours and hours contemplating other titles. For a while, I was thinking of using Other Arthur, which is kind of a mouthful.
Oh no, Heft, and Heft is so so distant from Theft.
But I think so. So finally, I wrote him a confessional email in which I said, "Dear Peter, I really have come up with a title that I think is right, but unfortunately, it's very close to a title of yours." And I told him, and he wrote back and said, "You're being ridiculous. Of course, use it. You know." So he's nice.
Is there a Dickinson poem, Certain Slant of Life, from, you know, this poem,
yeah.
Which runs?
Certain Slant of Life, yes, later afternoon.
To end with the Heft of Cathedral tune.
Oh, that's beautiful. Yeah, I know that poem, but I hadn't thought of that line until you said it. Yeah. That's nice. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, cool. Now I'll take that and say that that's one
that's
of the things that's wrong.
One of the things that struck me most reading you is the way in which you are so tender about the bodies of human beings. And I was thinking this in the context of this huge rush of forensic crime shows where we now have eviscerated bodies laid out like art objects. And I just wonder a little bit about that, whether you're conscious of that. I mean, it comes up, well, obviously with Arthur, but so many other characters. There's Nora Cross, the young girl who commits suicide again in the Words. There's that wonderful 80-year-old character also in Words that, what's her name, Pacifica Powers Klein. This very beautiful 80-year-old woman, and when she goes to the cemetery, the name of the cemetery, it's the
Greenwood.
Greenwood Cemetery. She clacks her teeth in solidarity with the skeletons. But there are so many instances, and I just wondered, everyone's body is so close to their skin, and you're so close to their skin as well. Were you conscious of that?
Yeah. Thinking about the body, poem about the body. There's a thing of being a woman in a developed country where it's impossible not, for me at least, I don't want to speak for everyone, but it's, I think it's impossible not to have to be very aware of one's own body and in a multitude of different contexts. And I guess that can be an advantage as a writer because you are close or very thoughtful about your own body, and maybe that transfers to your characters. And with Arthur, it was
so many writers don't, they're not, the body's in action, but then there's no component flesh or skin. It's just forward movement.
They're doing things. Maybe that's more athletic writers. I always had trouble with. I'm not athletic, and it was troubling to me as a kid because my most ardent desire in life was to be a soccer star. I really wanted to be one, and I played soccer terribly for years. And I'm tall, so I was the goalkeeper and. Just a terrible, terrible goalkeeper. Really, really goalkeeper. And so I don't know. I felt limited, and I didn't. Maybe it's that I don't feel like my body is all that good at doing these things. So instead, I think about the flesh of it, or I think about bodies being static, or but I don't know. That took us down a very weird road. But yeah, with Arthur, his body is very much a part of him. He talks about his body a lot. He thinks about his body a lot. Partly because it is him so much. Being 550 pounds, I imagine. It's just every movement that you make, you're thinking about your body. And it was sort of satisfying to write, or it was. An interesting thing to write because it let me.
Where did it come from? Fat man. Very large.
I think it came from the idea of allowing it. In some ways, it's a fear of mine to just one day say, I'm gonna eat whatever I want. I'm just gonna stop thinking about the body, and I'm gonna stop thinking about,
Do you think about what you eat?
Yeah, I think I should stop saying every, in my experience, my peers, in my experience, think a great deal about every morsel that goes into their mouth, and whether it's too much or too little, or how many calories it has, and I suppose that is in some ways, I think, it seems to me like maybe you disagree with this, a fact of being...
No, I think it's generational.
You think so? Yeah, I think so. Well, in any case, it is a fact of my life, and it's a fact of a lot of younger women's lives. And I'm careful to say in developed countries because I think that there's a whole. It doesn't sound, of course, when you don't have enough food, that is a far worse fate than something that is a completely separate issue. But I suppose that's partly Arthur came out of that experience of thinking a lot about food just as a product of being.
And she's like, "Will you write us for still?"
Really hot. I know. I'm pretty excited. Now I feel like everyone's going to be watching what I eat on the weekend.
No, I'm worried about your own internal,
it was an experiment in sort of imagining what it would be like to just stop thinking and go to a really opposite extreme. And I feel the need to say I've never had an eating disorder. I've never been, it's not anything clinical. It's just, it's just a fact. And I like to be honest about it because I think some people feel ashamed of or are afraid to talk about the idea that a lot of people really monitor what they eat.
But what's wonderful about Arthur is you get to really like him as a man, and as a man who thinks, and as a man who has this articulate conscience. And I won't say that the physical sense drops away, but when you can hear from that early reading, he's quite witty and he's devious. I love the way he chucks the poorly American plastic rubbish bag down from the top step and all of that. So it's hard to say the flesh drops away, but the answer that you follow through the novel, love.
I understand what you're saying. His body is a fact of him, but I felt the same way. My initial sort of the spark, the idea for Arthur, came out of the idea of what would it be like to be a man who is completely reclusive and a compulsive eater, and then from that idea came a whole other thing, and it's not this book was somewhat hard to get published initially. It was. I was working with an agent who signed this book based on the first 30 or 40 pages of it. And then when I turned in my complete draft, which is similar to this one, she, I think, had no idea what to make of it because she had been anticipating a book that was redemptive in terms of weight. I think she imagined that it would be the story of a before and after story. And it certainly is not that. I guess that wouldn't be giving away anything to say that it's not about a diet. At all. So she sort of very bluntly said, I don't really know what to do with this book. I think she was imagining lots of commercial possibilities with, Jenny Craig, Man and Weight Watchers, and
you still got the same agent?
No. I have an agent that I love and adore now. And he's young and hungry, like agents should be, I guess. So that worked out, but for a time I thought it wouldn't.
And tell us about Kel, because you said that you know that it's good, which I believe, because you're an honest woman. You just got inside an aspirant young baseballer's head, and so how?
I guess I.
You get the details right. The little I know about baseball.
Oh, the baseball was, unfortunately I'm not a fan of baseball, but it felt right for Kel to be a baseball player, partly because I think there's a section in the book where Kel talks about the idea that baseball is a very lonely sport to play for someone who doesn't have a father, which Kel doesn't, and it's also a very American sport. It's the American pastime, and it felt like the worst possible fate for a baseball star to be somewhat parentless, because there's all these stereotypes about, good job, son, and, baseball games and dads coming out and watching their sons play, and it's a very paternal,
very funny thing.
Yeah, a funny thing. So it felt like a sport that would be especially difficult for Kel to be good at. So that's then I had the problem of trying to find out enough about baseball to realistically write about baseball.
So what did you do?
I went to Mac and my fiance and said, you know, well, no, first I did, I have a friend who happened to have played in the minor leagues in the US for some time, so he was a good resource, and then I made Mac sort of proofread it at the end, and tell me if anything was horribly wrong that I was, there's one error that slipped in that has been pointed out to me over and over again.
Will Strand's been with it?
I don't know, it's about making a triple play all on one's own by catching a ball and throwing it, which I said that that Cal caught a pop fly and it would have had to have been a line drive. So in case anyone knows anything about baseball,
long about sign up.
Okay.
The other thing that I think is true of both books and is enormously enticing is the way in which you record houses. All of Liz's characters at one stage or another have a house. And it's cliche to say the houses are characters, but they are to some degree. And you talked a little bit before about living in Massachusetts in a poor area surrounded by rich areas. So there's that, and Kel going into the houses of rich kids, but there's Arthur's house. But in the words too, you like houses, don't you? Houses have all sorts of levels of resonances and meaning for you, don't they?
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. The brownstone, is that a word that...
Yeah. Winner brownstone, doing the brownstone.
Rome, yeah.
Let me explain.
Now I'm going to fail myself by not knowing. Are brownstones made out of limestone? You can tell me this. What is this called?
Granite.
Thank you. So they're connected, they're adjoining houses that are typical of neighborhoods like...
What we call terrace houses.
Terrace. Yeah. Oh yeah, I learned that word recently from Chris Wallace Pratt and Kristen Hemmel. They're joining in there,
and then you go up to
them. You walk up a set of stairs to get onto the main floor, and they're typical of neighborhoods like Park Slope in Brooklyn, which is where this book takes place. My grandparents they moved to Park Slope, Brooklyn, in the 60s. And they and their friends all bought brownstones, and they were cheap back then and are no longer cheap at all. They're more expensive than I could ever possibly afford. But I grew up going into these brownstones a lot whenever we visit my grandparents in Brooklyn. And I was fascinated by them. And a lot of their friends decorated with period furniture and furnishings and tapestries, and they just seemed very rich, not monetarily, but just, you know, palatial, culturally rich, and they were beautiful, and those homes really seemed like another world that I couldn't wait to get to as a kid, because I grew up in the suburbs and didn't really want to stay in the suburbs at all. So city houses I love.
But you've got country houses. You've got country houses that have got curtains made by the woman of the house, that have got cherries decorating the bottom, that strike the cheek of the daughter as she goes home.
Well done. Yeah, that's good.
I'm not.
Quick memory, though. I hadn't thought about that. The thing that Kel, I don't believe I said this, he grew up in Yonkers, which again is a poor neighborhood, a poor city just north of New York City. Poor, there are rich pockets, etc. But largely working class, and he goes to school in a fictional rich town in Westchester County that I called Pell's Landing. And that was fun to write because I do remember being very aware of other kids' houses growing up and trying to calculate, you know, who was richer and who was poorer based on the trappings of their homes. And even, you know, some weird stuff like the idea of having an island in your kitchen meant that you were rich, and the idea of, you know, it was all weird stuff that certainly infected the way Kel thinks about other people's houses and things that he notices. And also towels were a big thing. Having very plush towels meant that you were rich, and plush, you know, beds. Yeah. none of our towels, you know, matched growing up, so that meant that we weren't rich.
Just because we're going to run out of time soon, in the words of every song, you touch on what fame costs and what it feels like for the people who get close to it and get burned by it. But also in Heft, you write very movingly about encounters with notoriety and then turning away and shutting away. I wonder when you're singing, did you get a sense of suddenly being someone that an audience would be electrified by? Is that where that comes
yeah.
from? And where does the turning away, the hiding part come from?
I was never close to being famous as a singer in New York. There were probably too many of us, but I worked at a pretty famous guitar store in New York City during college, which was the best and coolest job I will ever have. And
come on.
Yeah. It was a great college job, and it gave me lots of stories to tell.
Yeah.
And, you know,
yeah.
a lot of the stories and the words maybe some came out of my experience there. But there were a lot of famous musicians that came in.
Yeah.
So, you know, without dropping names, it was really a remarkable thing.
Oh, okay. Go. Drop a few names.
Let's see. James Taylor came in. Mike Myers, who's not a musician but an actor, I sold a guitar to him. Let's see. Billy Joel. I felt like someone was saying something. Let's see, Carly Simon came in, Roseanne Cash came in, lots of, you know, some of the most, and because I'm on a stage, I'm drawing a blank about other people, but if you ask me afterwards, I'll tell you some. There's Susan Sarandon, sorry, I'm going to just randomly keep saying names in the middle of whatever else I say, but there were a lot of famous people who came through, and I thought it was very interesting to see them, partly just, you know, for no noble reason, but also just watching how people interacted with them, and thinking about the way that I interacted with them, and then seeing working musicians who would never be famous, but were supporting themselves professionally. That was also very interesting. And the idea of turning away, I've been doing a lot of reading recently about the idea of introverts and extroverts and all the things that go along with being an introvert. I think I identify very strongly as an introvert, even though I like people and, you know, I can be social when called upon to be social, but I think my natural tendency is reclusiveness or being alone. And I've heard it said that introverts recharge when they're alone, and then their energy drains when they're in public. And extroverts have a feeling of their energy draining when they're alone and recharge when they're in public. So I would say I'm very much an introvert in that sense. I like to hide for a time at weddings, like find a little pocket by myself and sort of stand there and think about things for a while and then go back out and talk to people. So it was a satisfying thing to write from the point of view of someone who's self-identified as a real recluse and really introverted, and that's a part of me that I exaggerated in Arthur, but I can certainly relate to.
Let's have a little bit more Arthur,
okay,
and then we might open up to questions. If that's okay,
sure, absolutely. I'll read a very brief thing in Arthur's voice.
I'm going to say a little bit more of Arthur. I mean, really a little bit more of Heft, because I think these opening passages give you a sort of broadening funnel going up that way, sense of what the novel is about, and the poignancy of it.
I'll read a very short passage. This is just the very next chapter after what I was reading before.
When I had finished it, I held the letter in my hands before me and imagined sending it. It was a letter that I was reading from before. Imagined very clearly folding it into sharp thirds and taking with my right hand the envelope and inserting with my left the letter, and then sealing it, and then inscribing it with Charlene's address, which I know as well as my own. Oh, you coward, I thought. If you were worth anything, you'd do it. While writing it, I had felt a sort of grand relief, to be unburdening myself after so long to someone I cared for so deeply. It was a letter I had always imagined writing to her. But unsurprisingly, I was too afraid to send it, and so I told myself that it was a selfish sort of honesty.
The sort that Charmaine didn't need to be encumbered with anyway. The events that prompted me to write it are as follows. First, 3 days ago, the phone rang. I had been doing absolutely nothing, and it gave me a very great shock. I nearly jumped out of my skin. I waited a few rings to let my breathing settle before I answered. A voice came through the wires. Arthur? Someone said. Arthur off? Now, I do not get many personal calls, and my heart leapt at who it might be. Yes, I said. I whispered. Maybe I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much. Now, I can't see a thing, so how are we going to do this? We get some light up, or do we have a...
Donato will take
care.
I can take the light up to anyone who has a question.
All right, so if you can put your hand up so I can see you, or try to see you. There's one.
It's a very simple question, but I'd just like to know if Arthur is left or right.
Is Arthur left or right now? Oh.
He's right-handed.
Wow.
Like me. That's a good question. Why don't you ask?
Just the way you put the letter in the envelope was the left hand was
I that too.
I think people who are left-handed are quite different.
That's interesting. Yeah. Well, it's interesting you ask that too, because one of the reasons that I used, you know, ampersands and abbreviations is I always imagined Arthur sort of jotting down his thoughts at the end of the day. And maybe in a journal. I think of it as a written voice. So yeah, he would be writing in longhand with a few abbreviations.
And did you imagine, you did consciously imagine him as right-handed?
Yeah, I could very clearly picture him writing in a diary, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any more? Yes, over here.
Why did you make the protagonist male? I assume that, obviously throughout the book, relationships, and Devon that has to be male, but then when you first began, it could have been female. Mm-hmm.
I don't think it could have been female. The only way I can explain that is by saying that I think of if a character is appealing enough to write about, I already sort of know not everything about the character. Certainly, a lot of it comes out of writing, but enough about the character and the character sort of fully formed, so that I couldn't arbitrarily choose female or male. It would be a package deal, kind of. And it was nice. It was nice to. Part of it is, you know, it felt to me like a safe way to explore some of the things that I felt personally, because there was a certain distance to Arthur in terms of the way he looks and his gender and everything else. So that was a comfort to me while I was writing it.
I have two questions. First one is, do you write with a computer or a phone? And the second one is, resolving on that one, do you use a board or a schema in order to, you know, where your characters are going and you then make sure they get there?
Do you mean a physical, like a bulletin board or something?
Yes.
I write on a computer almost exclusively, except for that moment when I was sitting there listening to Mark Strand when I was writing in the diary. So maybe I should try that again, because I'm having some trouble with the book I'm writing now. Maybe I need to sit and find out where Mark Strand is reading next and bring my journal and sit there and wait for divine inspiration or Mark Strand inspiration. I don't know. And then as for your second question, I've never used any kind of physical arrangement of pages or ideas or I like seeing those in movies about writers though. Do you ever notice that writers always have these like massive maps on their walls and mathematicians and lots of other, I mean, that's a thing, but I've never done that. I have some friends that do that. Do you ever do that when you're writing?
I'm no positive that's all right.
Process.
Yeah. Maybe I should try
which
that.
Which I end up ignoring completely. Because I, somewhere, I remember. You have a phenomenal memory.
I do have lots of documents affiliated with any project that I'm doing, all saved in the same folder on my computer. So again, electronic documents, but I have hundreds of documents in the folder called PEFT on my computer.
And you go back and you move them.
Yeah, yeah. So I keep a timeline and...
So she does have a board. It's
yes,
just, it's just
an electronic board. Yeah, I guess I should have answered it that way. Yeah. I keep a timeline and sometimes I'll make notes about the details of characters and of course I still notice little inconsistencies later because you know for me it's impossible not to, but
yeah. This one here or this one there?
I guess I don't really know why, but almost at the end of the book.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And I just wanted to know, because there are times the book when as much as you love and sympathize with the characters, there are times they really annoy you. I don't know if you felt the same way. But I guess my question is, did they frustrate you at those times? And if they did, why?
I wonder if, I mean, there's this, an annoyance in the fact that they're not taking action in a certain way. Is that where it came from? I can see that. There's a sense that both main characters are static and they're unable to kind of break out of their routines at the beginning. And Charlene, too, is kind of unable to overcome the problems that she's having. And yeah, that is an annoyance. It's something that I'm annoyed about in myself, too, specifically when it comes to procrastinating about writing. But it's, I don't know, I guess it's a fact of humans. We are annoying. We're all kind of annoying. I suppose that it makes sense to be annoyed by characters too. I don't know if I answered your question, but I'm also annoyed by it. Yes, that's your answer.
An intelligent, rich, fat man stuck inside a house. For some of America's external critics, that's a fair description in the United States. Were you conscious of developing allegorical dimensions?
I would like to say that I recently heard that Australia is the only country that surpasses the United States. but yeah, there's a. I would say probably in this country too. There is. A negative stereotype about Americans doesn't come out of nowhere. I mean, there's a real problem with obesity that's I think largely linked to the socioeconomic problems that America has. Certainly, cheap food is oftentimes bad for you, There's a lot of unemployment. I mean, that you could spend a lot of time diagnosing where the problem of obesity comes from. But for me, Arthur's a separate.
He's not those things.
Yeah,
he's always just food.
No, he's well off. It's almost like he's made a conscious decision to give up at the start of the book, and for him, that includes eating whatever he wants, and he's very matter of fact about that. I didn't think of it as typical of obesity in America. I thought it was
wasn't trying to focus on the obesity. The allegorical aspects of the characters and the interactions they have opens up sorts of interesting issues about the way in which society thinks about itself. I was just wondering whether you were actually, when you're writing characters, you're not only loving the characters that you're writing, but you're also thinking about the symbolism that they embody
Do the characteristics of each character symbolize something about the larger story or about society?
The collective unconscious of society. You've got this Charlene who's the connector who doesn't speak, and the young, different dimensions of America and its possibilities. So the young girl is a baseball star, with potentiality in front of him, he's connecting with someone else. I haven't read a novel yet.
I certainly don't think consciously about inserting symbolism into the book to answer your main question.
But as an American, I suppose there are certain things that naturally come to me as subjects about which to write. Baseball wasn't one of them because, I don't know anything about it, but it was interesting to use. Baseball is so linked to America. It is the American pastime. I guess that's where I most consciously thought about what it was to be an American or putting that into a book.
There's an aspirational dimension in the novel that
yeah.
I would say was characteristically American.
That's interesting because, so you said aspirational, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the character of Kel is very aware of class, kind of.
Shunning.
And Shunning, that's right, yeah. Their mother and son, so maybe he gets it honest, as we say. But the idea of class in America, I think, is different. I hear it discussed much more, or intentionally not discussed much more, in for example, Europe, where it's talked about in a different way in the U.S. It's almost like people want to pretend that it doesn't exist, right? But it certainly does. And there's this thought that in America, you know, anyone can make it, and anyone can,
as long as you're a millionaire.
Right, as long as you already happen to be a millionaire. But it doesn't ring true to me, at least. I don't think that anyone can make it. I mean, there's a lot of people that just won't ever make it. And that's, you know, certainly one side of the political spectrum would argue that that's their fault, and the other side would argue that that's society's fault, and probably the truth lies someplace in the middle. But it was interesting. I think class is a thing that should be talked about more. I don't know. It was interesting.
I think it's implicit. I'm not answering for you. I think there are symbolic resonances. It's not as if you've gone about to do it that way. It emerges.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's true. It's tough to insert symbolism. I don't think.
Interesting thing. Tell me if this is true. Just quick answer. The novel's a colored line.
How so? You mean in terms of race?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You discover incidentally.
Yeah.
That a character is poor.
Yeah.
That a character is black, but it's the least significant fact.
Yeah.
And I think that wouldn't have been possible.
I don't know. In some ways, I don't feel qualified to talk about the subject of.
It's not a subject. It's just the phenomenon of the books.
Right. Yeah. I guess you're right. I mean, I don't know where that comes from. Right.
Yeah.
I certainly grew up in a very diverse community.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of my friends were people of other races. A lot of my friends still are people of other reasons. I guess it wasn't, again, that was not intentional. But there it is.
You wrote your first novel when you were very young, and your second novel was obviously quite a journey and a mature one.
It's never helpful.
Can you tell us how you felt when you finished the second novel compared to how you felt when you were that young thing, you finished the first novel?
Yeah, that's a nice question. I the first novel was, it honestly felt almost accidental because I began writing it, clearly I'm still jet lagged. I began writing it while I was still a college student, and I was writing it as classwork, part of it. And I started to make the stories linked after about the third story. So it felt, you know, I was writing it for class and I finished it after college, but it was a series of fortunate events that led to its publication. And it, you know, I hate myself as a writer for how easily I got that first book published.
Oh,
but, well, I know I'm saying it, it's always, you never like, I think people like to hear about stories of
struggle
and overcoming. That book was a breeze to get published, for probably a lot of the wrong reasons. I think it was a, you know, kind of a sexy topic, and I was young at the time, and it was, if it went to the right person, and an offer was made very quickly, and nothing all that huge happened with the first book, but I didn't realize you know, I didn't know enough to know how easily I had it when I published that first book. And then my first agent retired after that book, so I paid my dues with the second book in trying to get Heft published. And I also paid my dues a bit more in writing Heft because I, to be honest with you, I worked harder on it. You know, I felt more interested in making it as good as it could possibly be. And I, you know, I like, I'm proud of having written the words of every song, but it feels to me almost like, I don't know how to put it, like a diary of my own life, or like a good keepsake for me or something. And, you know, certainly I hope that others like it as well, but it's, Heft is more meaningful to me as a writer. I guess that's a very honest answer, but that's my answer.
Well, it's good though, isn't it? Because sometimes the first book is the great one, and then spend a lot never getting there.
So. Yeah, it feels like my, it feels adolescent in some way. I mean, maybe for good reason.
Well, you were.
No, that's
what
part of it.
Maybe more hands on there. Can't see. Thanks, Tom.
You talked about learning from some of the mistakes of your first book. Mm-hmm. How often do you revisit your published work, and how do you approach it?
Daily, I just Google myself. I haven't read the words of every song since it came out, except to do brief, you know, readings from it from time to time. Aloud in public, not to myself. I haven't read Heft all the way through since I published it. You know, with both, the last time I read them through was after the copy editor had his or her way with them, just to make sure nothing went horribly awry.
How much editing did you have?
Not all that much. There was some back and forth with my editor, in ways that I now recognize as, I think she was right about certain things that at the time I felt vehemently against. I did. She wanted to cut out a scene. There's a high school party scene, mm-hmm. that she wanted to completely excise, and that was the real. That was my moment of, you know, standing and delivering and saying, I won't cut that scene. And a lot of people have pointed out that scene in particular as something that they've responded to. So I'm glad I stuck to my guns on that one. But there were other things. My editor did make the book better. I recognize that, yeah.
You'll ask me to thank this one.
Please join me again in thanking Liz and Morag for a really wonderful first night at the festival. So
thank you.
Stefano, what does the Writers' Festival in Ventura bring to the economy and the arts in
I don't think that a Writers' Festival per se can do a great deal in an immediate sense for the economy, but it lifts the spirit of the town, it gives the town a certain prestige, a certain colour, if you like, which can only be good. A town to be viable has to engage with hardcore economic activities, but it must also engage with things that are good for the soul, for the spirit. Then it is a complete town and a civilized town. And I think that the Majura story is a very rich one, because this community has shown the ability to go well beyond what is normally expected of a rural community. It is very sophisticated. It has the courage, if you like, to bet above its league. And that can only be good. Excellent.
What would happen if you didn't have festivals like this?
Well, if you don't have festivals of music, of literature, of all the other art forms, you have a very dull and very poor community. Everybody would be home watching silly television programs. This is where the ideas fall, where ideas are compared. this is where the community challenges itself. And it's not just what you see, it's also what goes on behind the scene. Now getting sponsors, getting volunteers. That weaves a good story, a good heartfelt story. And that's important too.
I think the arts mix as well with food.
Oh well, that goes without saying.
My daughters and I have been coming to the festival for years and we absolutely love it every year. We always have a wonderful time and we meet the most fascinating, wonderful writers, enjoy new books, have a great time, eat beautiful food. It's a highlight of the year.
This is a selection of wonderful things from Mildura.
Urbancic Jr. I'm the U.S. Consul General in Melbourne, responsible for Northern Territory, South Australia, Victoria, and Tasmania, including Antarctica. Well, I'm here in the Writers' Festival because the United States and Australia have a tremendously good and fundamentally deep relationship. It goes far beyond government-to-government things. It goes far beyond just military things and other government cooperation. We have a people in the United States who look at the world the same way that Australians do in almost 99% of the times. We're different countries, but we share a frontier experience. We share a common history in the Pacific, and we share, I think, a very, very bright future together. And so the United States wants to make sure that we are working on all levels with our Australian friends, and this is just a part of that. Plus, I'm responsible specifically for the central part of the country, and this is one of the major regional cities. So there's a dozen reasons to be here.
So how did you get involved with writing?
Well, I myself am not a writer. I'm not that smart, but I admire people with talent, and I follow writing, and I follow cultural events. I personally read history. I'm particularly interested in classical and Byzantine history, but I admire people who can put a story together and who can tell the story of another person, of another people's, and that's certainly what we're doing here.
Did you enjoy the night?
Oh, well, you can see the smile on my face. Yes, I think I did. It was splendid. I must say there's been very few, in fact there have been zero, events that I've been to in Australia that I haven't enjoyed, because the people everywhere in this country are truly spectacular.
So how do you feel, obviously writing brings a cultural richness to any
yes.
area. If there wasn't festivals like this around the world, what would happen?
Well, we'd be a much poorer place. There'd be much less thought, there'd be obviously less creativity, there'd be less cross-cultural dialogue. You heard tonight some discussions about specifically American subjects, which were then reinterpreted by Australians and looked at in different ways and perhaps were symbolic of the United States or by the author herself, perhaps not. But what she wrote certainly resonated with the man who was asking the question about the larger implications of her novel. We wouldn't have that kind of discussion if there weren't creative people writing things.
What would you say to up-and-coming writers?
You know, I would say what I say actually to up-and-coming youth that I meet with so often, follow your dream. If this is what you want to do, if you have a message to tell in the case of writers, then tell that and make it clear to other people that you have something of value to say and engage in discussions with them. Put it on paper and put it out there. Take risks, and you can really never lose if you take a risk.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.